So, for those of you that are visiting with us, we kind of help catch you up a little bit. And for those of you that have been here, we'll set the pace. We'll set the stage for what's going on. We have actually been doing a series of messages talking about the seven words of love. These were actually seven groups of love, of words that Jesus spoke on the cross in his last dying moments that he was saying. And today we come to the end that he is talking about. And in my house, and actually I've bought a lot of them here, and I've gotten a lot smarter over the ages. I've got a lot of books, a whole lot of books. And generally when I was little or earlier in my life, I was able to actually read about one book a day. And somebody would ask the question, well, how does you read one book a day? It's great. It's large print and a lot of print pictures. And so if you, well, it's not hard to watch Jane, run, watch Spock. Watch Spock, Dick and Jane. Dick and Jane go to a grocery store or something, you know? And you get the pictures and all of the stuff, but they make great books, especially bedtime stories and everything else. You know, it's kind of there. But one of the things that I mean, when you go through life, you always kind of remember the last words that somebody has said. Those are the words that kind of just stick in your mind. The last conversation. For me, my dad, I had a heart attack. I was in the service. I had just been gone 6 months. Actually, 5 months. It's just gone 5 months, and I got a phone call. You got to come home. Red Cross is trying to get you a flight. Your dad had a heart attack, and you need to get home as soon as you can. I got the call on Tuesday. I finally made it home by Thursday, catching flights and everything. I got stuck in New York Wednesday. So I made it home Thursday and got to walk in there and see my dad. And just kind of talk to him and say, how you doing? Well, doing better. And then we stayed 24 hours with him. We stayed Thursday, Friday, and then Saturday morning, they came in and they said, he's doing better. This was in 1976. He's doing better. We're going to move him into another room. He's stabilized. Everything's fine. So I looked at all of my brothers and sisters and all of them. I said, guys, I got to go home and take a shower to my in-law's house. They're very old. I just need to go take a shower and see my wife and check on my little baby boy, who at this time is about 10 months old. So I go to see. This is one of those obvious connections to, okay? Because I went home, I grabbed my deed, and I took a shower. As I was walking out the door, the phone rang. I was just getting ready to go out the garage and get into the car. And my wife said, you need to come here for a minute. I said, what's wrong? And she said, we just got a call. You need to get to the hospital right now. So I flew from Fairfield to back to the hospital, because it had only been about an hour and a half before that I sat down and was talking with my dad when he told me that he was getting better. My dad had habits, and that was he loved a Milky Way bar and a Dr. Pepper. That's what I get from Coke and Reese's Cups. He always liked to read the newspaper. I was sitting there that morning and I said, Dad, I got you a Dr. Pepper, I got you a Milky Way bar, I got the newspaper. Would you like for me to read it to you? And he said, yeah. He said, son, I'm tired. I just want to go sleep for a little bit. So by the time I got back, of course, so those are the last words. I'm tired. Just want to go sleep now. And so a lot of times, when you go through life, you're going to remember the last.
last words that he was about to hear.
Amen.
And today, we're going to come to the last words that Jesus spoke. And they're powerful. They really are. If you read some books, I guess some funny books, there was a guy by the name of James Rogers who was going to face a firing squad in Utah. And they asked him, they said, "Do you have any last requests before we shoot you?" And he said, "Yes, a bulletproof vest." General John Sedgwick, who was a commander in the Union Army during the Civil War, he was killed on the battlefield while he was looking at the enemy. And here's what he said. "Those Confederates couldn't hit an elephant at this distance." That was it. Another famous quote is from Pontovia. He said, everybody knows who he is, right? He's that famous Mexican leader. His last words was this: "Don't let it end like this. Tell people I said something." So, if you got your notes, hang with me. If you don't, there's words are up on the screen. So let's go. Luke chapter 23, verses 44 to 47. Now, it said by this time it was noon, because Jesus had been on the cross for 3 hours or 6 hours. Okay? It says the darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. And we've been talking about this, okay? Now, we don't know why it got dark until the Bible says it got dark. God caused it to get dark. He could have done anything he wanted to do to make it dark. He's God. He controls it all. So he made it dark in the middle of the day when it wasn't supposed to be dark, okay? It said, the light of the sun was gone. And suddenly, the thick veil hanging in the temple was torn apart. And there's a lot of symbolism in that, and I'm going to talk about the symbolism in that, because that's another sermon for another day, okay? But the Bible says that then Jesus shouted. Most people, when they are dying, ladies and gentlemen, do not shout. They whisper. But the Bible is very plain when it said, then Jesus shouted. And here are the words that he shouted. "Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands." And with those words, he breathed his last breath. When the captain of the Roman soldiers, that was the centurion that was at the foot of the cross, that was there to watch all of the people die, he was in charge of all of these. It says when the captain of the Roman soldiers, handling the execution, saw what had happened, he praised God. There is no way that a Roman centurion would be at the foot of the cross praising God. That is not an everyday event that is happening. But he did. He praised God. And here's what he said. And he said, "Surely this man was innocent."
Amen.
Now, if you read the caption, or if you read the story in the book of Matthew, Matthew will tell you that the Roman soldiers said, "Surely this was, or this man was, the Son of God." Okay? So you see just the two differences. But here you have a hardened soldier at the foot of the cross. He has seen execution after execution after execution. And he's probably looked up and seen all these people hanging there when they're saying, "Hey, why don't you get us down? We're not really guilty. We're innocent of our crimes. And we shouldn't really be here." Somebody made a mistake. They trumped up the charges. You know, generally when you go into court, everybody's innocent. You know, somebody's putting me up to this. So this guy, he is there all the time. Generally, when people were dying, it took them days to die. They're drained of all of their energy and they suffocate on the cross. They can barely speak. Generally when you are, I don't know about you, but I've been around when a lot of people are taking their last breath. They're not shouting. They're gasping and saying, sometimes you just got to get over real close to them to hear what they're saying. But not Jesus. Jesus is on the cross. And Jesus, with a loud voice, he didn't say, "Father, I entrust my soul to you." That's what he said. "Father, I entrust my soul to you." Everybody heard him. And that Roman soldier, he says, looks up there. He'd never seen anything like this before. He's been watching all the dialogue and all the events that have happened from Jesus on the cross to his mother Mary, to his servant John, talking to the thief on the cross, talking to the crowd. And here he's looking and he's saying, "Man, this guy did not deserve to die. Surely he was innocent of his crime. He didn't belong to be there." And this is what he was saying. He was there when Jesus was looking at the thief on the cross, and when the thief said, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he remembers Jesus turning to him and saying, "Today shalt thou be with me in paradise." We're both coming off this thing. Not the way you want to come off of it. We're going to die, but guess what? We're going to still live. All these other people around here, they're all going to die in there and have no clue what's happening next. But you, I get you coming, brother.
Amen.
It's me and you. When you die, I'll be there with you. You don't have to worry about it. I believe Jesus will say it to you. When you get home, I'll be waiting for you. I'll be waiting for you. You see, because a lot of times, nobody from the cross had ever said, "Father, forgive them." They don't know what they're doing.
Amen.
That Roman soldier at the foot of the cross never heard that. He never heard anybody say, "Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands." Nobody. But let me say this to you, and I wrote it down on your outline. You can just follow with me, and let's just go through it real quick. Here are some things where people just don't die like this, but there was something different about Jesus. He was at peace. It was his time to die. He was at peace.
Amen.
He wasn't afraid to die. Number three, he died with no unreconciled relationships.
Amen.
Which most people never, ever do.
Amen.
I say to you today, if you've got a relationship that you need to reconcile, you need to reconcile it now.
Amen.
Because you don't know if it's you or them. One may be going home. And the problem is you can't, and I hear people all the time say, "I just wish I had told them. I just wish I had said this. I just wish I had visited this. I just wish, I just wish, I just wish." Don't wish. Make it happen.
Amen.
Make it happen. And this is the way Jesus was. He wasn't angry. He wasn't bitter. Many times, I don't know about you, but I watch people, a husband, laying in a coffin, and a wife coming up, or a wife going and a husband coming up and saying, "Why do you leave me? Why didn't you go? It wasn't supposed to happen this way. We're supposed to go together." And I know how you feel. Listen to that, gave up my life. I gave up a daughter before we got to home. Our first child.
Amen.
Having the doctor come out and say, "We lost the child. We almost lost your wife." And they were making decisions without anybody talking, telling us that we would never have children. We have three. I've got 8 biological grandchildren and 1 adopted. I have 9 grandchildren.
Amen.
It never supposed to happen.
Amen.
But I have to tell you, when I'm standing there and my wife is in pain, and I can't even go in to talk to her and tell her, "I'm sorry, but our daughter didn't live." When I walk in there, she asks me, she says, "How is Robin?" And I lied and I told her she's fine. My wife looked at me, and even though we'd only been married 2 years, she knew me. And she said, "You're..."
said, we have to talk later. And I just couldn't talk about this. And I look back at that moment because I was angry and I was bitter. God, why? Because the doctors, well, what they had told me, I was saying, you know, that's, this isn't fair.
Amen.
I get over it. And I understand. Don't get angry. Don't get bitter.
Amen.
He knew where he was going. He's confident in heaven. Number six is he trusted God with his future. When he said, I entrusted my spirit into your hands. So, let's go, because I got to get you out of here before 1 o'clock. Number one. First, you need to understand something. Christ gave up his life voluntarily. Nobody took it from him. If you go into John chapter 10, verse number 18, it says, no one can take my life from me. He says, I lay it down. I lay it down my life voluntarily. For I have the authority to lay it down. And when I want to, and also the power to take it back up again. So even though the death on the cross, sometimes we look at it, ladies and gentlemen, the death of the cross of Jesus Christ was not a tragedy.
Amen.
Jesus chose to take the cross. He chose to give his life up, not to let somebody else take it down. Secondly, he gave his life, he gave up his life confidently. Okay? There's a lot of people who have no clue. Sometimes you're standing there and you're talking to them and you ask them, are you ready? No, I'm not. What's wrong? I'm not sure where I'm going. And you're sitting there and thinking, a whole life. And you're not confident what's going to happen in that moment. I know none of us have died and come back again. But let me say this to you. You can't be confident where you're going. And know for a fact. Because this is what God wants us to do. And this is why I am who I am. When I say I am a Jesus fan, I am.
Amen.
I am. I'm a Cincinnati Reds fan. I don't care if they're winning or losing. I will sit in front of that TV and I will cheer. Okay? When they strike out, we'll get them next time. There's another time. Oh, there's another game tomorrow. There's this, there's that. Oh, there's next year. You know, we'll practice ship. It'll be okay. Now, don't do that for the Bengals. Okay? Haven't quite moved over to that dark side. That's a hard one. Because that's putting a lot of trust in something. But I am a firm believer. I went to church all my life. And I was always told what not to do. You can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do that. And as a matter of fact, when you go to church, you must sit there with your hands and on your knees, or hit this like, you can have your hands open as long as you have the Bible in it, or a hymn book. You're not supposed to get loud. Only the preachers get loud. You are to sit there as a little kid and pay attention.
Amen.
I'm not good with rules. That was the right one. Amen. I have to train the rest of them. Yeah, stick around for a while. I might need you another one. So, we were always getting into trouble. What are you doing back there? Hey, we're paying attention. I can tell you the last 10 sentences you said. Why? Because I heard that sermon 28 times. It was the same sermon. Everyone in the band changed it. They just switched up some things. Every once in a while they would switch it up in the mess. So anyway, I'm a firm believer because I have an issue. Okay? I understand that we are supposed to be respectful of the house of God. I also am a firm believer that you should pay attention. I am also a firm believer that it's okay to show emotion in church. When I go to a baseball game and Jake Bruce hits a winning run, wasn't that a good shot? That was an awesome home run. No, don't even go to a game. That didn't really happen. If he hits a home run, it's great, it's wonderful.
Woo!
Yes! Did you just see that? I get excited about them the way y'all get excited about the Bengals. Right? Okay? If I was to go to your house and watch a football game and they're winning, y'all going nuts. Your neighbors know about it. The whole town knows about it. Everybody on the street knows the Bengals are winning. The problem is when we come to church, it's nice seeing you today. How you doing? You got a nice dress on, lovely smile. How are you this week? You know? And it's like, okay, whatever. You know, it's are you a fan of Jesus? You know what a fan is? A fan is a fanatic.
Amen.
If I am a fanatic for something that is temporary, why can I not be a fanatic for something that's permanent?
Amen.
I don't know about y'all, but I like things that last.
Yeah.
I do not like to buy a car that only lasts 3 months. I've got a Honda City out there that I bought in 2005. It is now 10 years old. It has got 270,000 miles on it. My wife says, when are you going to trade it in? I am not.
Amen.
It is dependable. It gives me where I'm going. I'm still getting 37 to 38 miles to the gallon. It's wonderful. I love gas prices when they're going back down. It doesn't really bother me when they go back up because I'm still not paying that much. Okay? But it will never get below that, due to taxes. But anyway, Jesus gave up his life trusting God, okay? And when Jesus says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, you need to understand something. How many of you all have taught your children this little story? Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord, my soul to keep. And if I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. How many of y'all have said it? And how many of y'all taught your kids that prayer? Do you know where this comes from? It comes out of the Bible, out of Psalms 31. Okay? In Psalms 31, Jesus was probably taught the same little thing because in Psalms chapter 31, this was a phrase, and actually, it's in Psalms chapter 31, and you can read it later on, in verse number 5, okay? And what it says is this. It's telling the people, every Jewish child would learn this, and they would regularly pray this at the end of the day. And what Jesus was doing was using the same prayer at the end of his life that he had been taught as a child to say. And the phrase has been around for over 2,000 years. In Latin, the phrase is, and my Latin's not that great either. My English is just so. It's Emanaeus tuus domini commendo spiritum meum. Which basically says, in your hands I commit my spirit. And we've been teaching our kids this little phrase and they have no clue where it came from. And it's been around for years. Jewish kids are still saying this phrase. They're being taught this phrase all of the time. And Jesus is saying this. Do you remember in the Bible a guy by the name of Stephen? Remember when Stephen was there and was being stoned and he was about ready to die? What did he say? He said, Father, receive my spirit. Father, receive my spirit.
Being taught the same thing, Lord, I entrust my spirit into you. Well, you need to understand, number one, in your notes, you can keep
piece if you like. If you don't, that's okay. Number one is, I have a Father in heaven who loves me. Okay? That's why Jesus started his last statement was with Father. Now remember, a few weeks ago, we were teaching he didn't call God his Father. He called him my God, why has thou forsaken me? When he had taken all of the sins of you and I, he was no longer 100% man and 100% God. Now he's 100% man. And at that point, when he's taking your sins and my sins, and God can't even look at him because he's got the sins, he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Prior to that, he was talking to his Father. After this, now at the very end, he's talking to the Father. He says, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirits. Jesus, when he taught us to pray, how did he say, here's what you need to do. Our Father. When you pray to your Father. Amen. You pray to him. But people didn't understand this because up until this point, people didn't talk to God that way. And here's Jesus coming up and upsetting everything, telling them everything you've been taught is wrong. You see, because in the Arabic or in the Aramaic world today, or in the Aramaic world that was back then, you need to understand that in the Middle East, the first word that a child is taught is Abba. Or Dada. Or Papa. Children are taught, this is my Father. Okay? So Jesus was telling us, he said, listen, there it is. The Bible tells us in John chapter 16, verse 28, he says, I came from the Father, entered the world. Now I'm leaving the world and I'm going back to the Father. I came in through the Father, I'm going back to the Father. It's where he is. Now, I'm telling you something. I don't know if you're going through anything today. I don't know if you're going through a financial crisis. I don't know if you're going through a physical crisis, a conflict in your marriage, a conflict in your life, a conflict in your job, whatever. But I want to tell you something. You've got a Heavenly Father that is close to you, he cares, and he's competent of handling the situations. Whatever they are, he is not too little or too big that he can't handle. And that he wants to handle it. Okay? I need you to write something down on your outline if it's not there. And that is this. God loves me more than I do. God loves me more than I do. There are times we don't like ourselves. There are times that we don't like what we see in the mirror. There are times we don't like what we've shown other people. There are times and regrets we wish we could have brought it back. The words we said. But let me say this to you. Even in those moments that you're going through, God loves you more than you do.
Amen.
He will always love you. And that's how it starts. Number two is my Father can be trusted. Okay? There were times growing up, my father had a temper. And there were times that I didn't know what my dad was going to do. I didn't know if he was going to hit you or praise you. And so most of the time, he just kind of backed away. When my mom and dad were fighting, it was time to leave the house.
Amen.
You had no clue what was going to happen next. Most of the time, it ended up with my mother throwing the dishes or the fireplace. And as I said, when we grew up, we never had one complete set of dishes at our house. Ours was multicolored because the rest of them, the plates had been broken. But let me ask you a question. And that is this. One of the biggest decisions you're going to have to ever make in your life is, who do I trust? Whenever you get married, you got to trust the person.
Amen.
And there are some times they may bend that trust. And then there are some times you begin to start losing those trusts. If I was to take a survey this morning and ask you, how many of you all trust Congress? saying trust, get things straight. And nobody does. Why? How many of y'all trust the media? I believe everything that's out there, that's ever written on Facebook, on the internet, it's all true. It's got to be because it's written, right?
Thanks for the laugh.
Let me make you a recommendation this morning. Let me make you a recommendation that you trust in someone who knows the best.
Amen.
Who will always put your interests first. That whenever you need to talk to him, he will never say, hold on a minute, I'm talking to someone else.
Amen.
Who doesn't really have to stop what he's doing to give you his full attention.
Amen.
Or better yet, will always tell you the truth.
Amen.
Even when it hurts. He will not tell you what you want to hear. He will tell you that. You see, there's only one person that I know that can do that. And his name is God.
Amen.
He is perfect. Without no spots. Without no blemishes. There's the bumper stickers that always say, God said it, I believe it, and that settles it. I got a new bumper sticker for you. That is, God settled, God said it, that settles it whether I believe it or not.
Amen.
He doesn't ask me, did I believe it? He said, I said it. Now what are you going to do about it? Okay? You need to understand that what Jesus said was, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. And the word that he used here was a Greek word called peritai themai. Okay? And peritai themai actually meant entrust, or it was a word kind of like a safety deposit box. If you've got a lot of, you've got something valuable, you go to the bank or you go somewhere, you get a safety deposit box, you put it in there and it's got a key and nobody else can get in there. You're the only one that's got the key. And that's what Jesus was saying to the Father. He was saying, Father, I have entrusted my spirit to you. Nobody else can get in here and unlock it. It's in your control. I don't control it. Nobody else controls it. You control it. You determine what it is. So my question to you is this. Have you entrusted yours to him?
Amen.
Have you said, Father, here is my spirit. Here's my soul. Here's everything that I am. Because you got to understand that he's going to always be there. Okay?
Amen.
Now the problem is that a lot of times as children, we learn the difference between right and wrong. But yet sometimes you need to understand some things because there's a whole bunch of things about trusting God that we need to get out. And for those of you that are visitors, I don't know what church you go to, and so our beliefs may be a little bit different. That's okay, we can discuss them. I won't apologize for mine. But it's not because I'm always right. It's just that here's some things that I think sometimes we've been taught that may not be absolutely correct. Okay? And here's some of them. Number one, there are times that people will ask me, what about babies? And you have to understand, I lost mine. So the question is, where is that little girl? Is she non-existent? Is she there? Or whatever else? And I did a lot of searching to find out where is she. My answer that I got back from God is, she is in heaven. The Bible says in Psalms 116 and verse 6, the Lord protects the simple-hearted. Okay? That is the child. There are some people who are mentally challenged, whatever you want to call it. They go through life and this later, and they may be 50, 60 years of old age, and somebody says, well, did they go to heaven? Absolutely.
Amen.
Absolutely. Because the capacity that they have is as a child, not as an adult. Capacity is not determined, ladies and gentlemen, by age.
Amen.
Okay, so where did they go? The Bible says that it protects the simple hearted. Okay, how do I know that? Let me give you the example that is found in Samuel chapter 1. It was when David had an infant son. And what did David say? In Samuel chapter 1, he says, can I bring him back to me? The answer is no. I will go to him someday, but he will not return to me. David knew where that child was. When the child died, he was in the presence of God. Okay? Here's another one. What happens about people who are true believers and then later on in life stop believing? Are they going to fall away? They kind of fall away from their faith here. And the Bible said, the question is this. Well, what's going to happen to those people? Maybe they go join a cult or something. What happens to them? And the question is, people will ask them things. Well, do they lose heaven? Do they lose a reward in heaven? Let me say this to you. They don't lose their salvation.
Amen.
They don't. And it's like this. Because the Bible says very plainly, if I am your child, okay, and y'all should have said the Bible. If Michelle is married to someone and they adopt me, they adopt me, okay? The Bible says there is no way she could ever disown me.
Amen.
No matter what I do.
Amen.
Jewish custom was if you had adopted a child, that's your child. Amen. Now, if I was her blood child, she could disown me for what I'm doing.
Yes.
But as an adopted child, never.
Amen.
This is why in the Bible, Jesus is talking all of the time about adoption. He says, you've been adopted into the family of God. And so, here's what he says, okay? He says, listen, in 2 John chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, many deceivers who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh have gone out into the world. He says, watch out that you do not lose what you have worked for. Watch out that you don't lose what you've worked for, but that you may be rewarded for. Now the question is, do you work for your salvation? No, that's not what he's talking about. What he's talking about is you're working for your rewards. You're working for your rewards. You don't work for your salvation.
Amen.
You haven't got anything that you can give to God. He's already done it on the cross. Okay? Now, I hear this all the time. I hear people ask me all the time, so what is the unpardonable sin? Okay? And I hear this all the time. And somebody says, well, isn't suicide an unpardonable sin? And the answer is no.
Right.
It is not. Okay? In fact, the Bible says there is only one sin that is unforgivable. Just one. It can't be two. There's only one.
Amen.
And in order to commit the unpardonable sin, you've got to understand that what the Bible is telling us, there were a lot of people who were very depressed in the Bible. David was one. Jeremiah was one. Job was one. And look who they are. They're great believers. Can Christians get depressed? Absolutely.
Amen.
We're reading it in the newspapers all the time. Rick Warren, who was out in California, his son Matthew committed suicide from depression. Another guy, I got a book, he wrote about his daughter. The book is called Melissa. The guy is a very well-known preacher. His name is Paige Patterson. And very well-known. He talks about the suicide of his daughter. Depressed. Can Christians get depressed? Yes, ladies and gentlemen, you can. The Bible is full of people who are believers who are depressed.
Amen.
That doesn't make you a non-Christian.
Amen.
Or a non-believer. Okay? And so what happens is, there were people in the Bible who actually asked God to kill them, to take their lives. Moses asked God to take his life. Elijah asked God. Jonah asked God. And I don't know about you, but that's pretty depressing. To get to that point where you say, God, take me. Get me out of here. Okay? So you need to understand some things. And I gave you a scripture that's already there to tell you that it can't happen. Okay? So let me finish up. I won't finish up with all of this because we need to get the kids. Okay? So if you'll get them, okay, got them. Do they have a change of clothes?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So they'll get a change of clothes. I'll be finished here in just a minute.
I'll
have that. And then I'll get them. Okay? And this is number three. My Father's taking care of things that I can't see. There's a lot of things in your life, ladies and gentlemen, that you have no clue. But you know something? God's got it. He's got it covered. Okay? And we need to understand some things. That while you're waiting, God's working. And so many times we forget about this. He says in Job chapter 23, verses 9 and 10, it says, when he, talking about God, is at work in the north, I do not see him. When God turns to the south, I catch no glimpse of him. Okay? But he, talking about God, knows the way that I take, and when he has tested me, I will come forth as gold. So God knows where you're going. He knows the direction that you're headed. And what God is trying to do is tell you that I'm here. I'm here. I know where you're at every moment of the day. You can't hide from it. Number four, my Father can handle anything that I put in his hands. Anything. The Bible says that the Lord will hold you in his hands for all to see, a splendid crown in his hands of God. The Bible also says in John chapter 10, verses 28 and 29, Jesus said, I give them, that's you, eternal life. And here's what he says. When I give you eternal life, Jesus is talking to you. He says, listen, they shall never, what?
Perish.
Why? Because my Father, who has given them to me, is greater than them all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. Satan is not powerful enough to take you from God. Yes, can't do it. Here's the problem. When you gave your life to Christ at the moment of salvation, it's no longer yours. It's his. Now, can you still make decisions? Absolutely. He will let you make those decisions. And what happens? You suffer the consequences of the decisions that you make. Every decision, ladies and gentlemen, that you make in your life has a consequence. If you make the right decision for God, the consequence of that is God's got a blessing for you. He's going to reward you for it. Part of that blessing you get here. The rest of it you're still and you get later. And let me say this to you. If you ever lose your faith, you will not lose the rewards that you've already done. You will lose the rewards that you could have had. Those things. I keep telling everybody, and I don't like to use this terminology, but this is the best thing I can do. That is, God has got a clearance sale going on in heaven and the whole universe. He is giving away everything. He isn't like one of these. Did you see these signs out here? You guys can. God isn't like these signs. Did you see these stores that are closing? Everything must be sold. And then they close that store down and they move down the street. Or they just turn around and just change the name and then they move right back in there. God doesn't do that. God's got a clearance sale. Here's what he's doing. He's giving everything away, but he ain't moving. He's letting us move in with him. And that's the best part about all of it. You're going to see an example in just a few minutes of two young kids. And some people will say, little kids have no clue what they're doing. They have to know a lot more than we know. The Bible says that we trust by faith. God has given you enough faith to trust him. You were born with it. The question is, what do you do with it? When Jesus said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. My question to you is this. When you go to die, who are you going to call upon? Are you going to call upon God? Or are you going to call upon Satan? Because one or the other is your father. here, but I'll tell you what, I will be shouting there. I may not have enough energy here, but you'll know I'm gone.
Oh, this is Pastor Chuck Cotton from Calvary Baptist Church. First of all, I'd like to say thank you very much for taking the time out to either listen to our sermon or to watch it on video. We are grateful that you've actually taken the time and hope and pray that it has been a blessing to you as it was to us as we delivered it to our congregation. We ask if you have any questions whatsoever that you email us at PastorChuck@CalvaryBaptistMiddletown.org, or you could come in and give us a phone call, if you would please, at area code 513-423-7251. I'd like to take this opportunity to also invite you to come to our church and visit us, if you would please. We actually have small groups on Sunday morning starting at 9:30, with our morning worship following at 10:45. Prior to our morning small groups, we also provide donuts with coffee, milk, orange juice, a time for fellowship, get to know each other, have a good time before we actually break out into our small groups for Sunday. Our worship services are uplifting, they're fast moving, and everything in our service is just a fast pace. But we do take time every once in a while to slow down as we feel the Holy Spirit moving, and we never want to hinder it in any way. We also have on Sunday evening, during the school year, we have Awana, and Awana starts with the Puggles, actually from age 2 all the way up through high school. And during that period of time, we also have a worship service. Both of these start at 6 o'clock and end at 7:30. Our Wednesday night, we have a Bible study, which starts at 7. We generally finish about 8:15. We would love for you to come and visit with us. Don't have to dress up. Just come as you are, because to us, it doesn't matter. You're a child of God, a creation of His, and so to us, you're important to everything that we do. Our motto here is building the kingdom one life at a time, and we hope that we have a chance to visit with you, get to know you as you get to know us. So thank you, and may God bless you.